as I mentioned last week, sometimes challenges in our lives, they can cause us to shrink back in our faith. They can cause us to grow in our faith. Or in the case of Josh, they reveal the depth of our great faith, and he is so encouraging. I want to come back to praying about Josh in just a second. And then after that teaching, we picked it up in verse 44, where we talked about together. And actually, if you'll remember, that Sunday, the verse says this, all the believers were together. We talked about the power of unity and the power of a vision, where God has called us to love a lost and hurting world. And we talked about the people that God's already used us to help bless them, and of God's, what we believe is God's desire that we would bridge the gap. That was the Sunday we broke ground out front, which, by the way, it's going to be a couple weeks yet before the bulldozers are here, literally moving the ground around, but it's coming. We broke ground, and we committed before you, the church, again, the vision that we believe God has called us to as we build a building that will not only bridge between our buildings, but it'll be a building that we can bridge into the community. More on that in just a second. And then last Sunday, we had entitled it Sacrificial. Notice what it says in verse 45. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. And we talked about the realization that all that we have is ultimately from God. All of our material possessions, and we are so blessed with so much to live where we live compared to the rest of the world, it is a gift from God, and we are managers of it. He's entrusted it to us. It's His, and we simply manage it. And we talked last week about the importance of tithing, or even moving beyond tithing, as many of you have done, and sacrificially given to the Bridging the Gap initiative. We talked about how tithing represents our belief that God actually owns everything, and we give back to Him the first 10% of it to acknowledge. He calls us to acknowledge that He is the owner, and we are managers of what He's given to us. And so we talked about the importance of that teaching. I'm actually going to come back to that here this morning and add in one other thing. It says they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes, and they ate together with glad and sincere hearts. And then the last verse, verse 47, which we've entitled Growing, and it simply says this. The early church was praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. With everything I've been describing going on, they were praising God, they were enjoying the favor of all the people. And notice what he adds in there after that. It says, and the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. So this kind of community that the Bible describes is a community that all these things are going on, and it's a community that naturally grows as it proclaims the teaching of Jesus and people come to find faith in Jesus as Savior and Lord. So as we begin this morning, I'd like to ask, I want to pray for Josh, and let me tell you kind of where what I'm just sensing. Again, can I ask everybody to stand? Can we stand and pray? Let's bow our heads. Kind Lord, we come before you this morning. And God, in our hearts, we lift our eyes up to you on behalf of us as a church and as a community. God, we pray that you would have your way with us, and that as much as possible, these things I've just described would be true of us. And we pray this, God, because we want to honor you and we want to love people well. Help us to love each other well, to love your truth well, and in loving you and your truth and each other, God, that you would use us to be a bridge to love a lost and hurting world. And as we come before you this morning, thinking about these things, we bring before you our brother Josh. God, we acknowledge that Josh is not the only one wrestling right now with cancer and other things, because there are others in our midst dealing with the same. God, we have them in mind as we call out to you for healing. And specifically, we say again, and we ask again, God, Please heal Josh, that he would praise you and glorify you and serve you mightily in this church and proclaim your word. Heal him, we pray, in Jesus' name. And everyone who agreed said,
amen.
Amen. Please be seated. As we read through the Bible and we see what is happening here, it's super interesting in terms of what God does amongst his people. And the reason I'm saying that is, as a church, we're in a very interesting season. Next Sunday, Les and Leslie Parrott will be with us. And we believe that this is a wonderful opportunity to invite our friends, relatives, neighbors, and others here on Sunday morning. In fact, you should have received a red sheet on the way in that says, love the life you live. Does everybody have that? Can you wave that at me if you have it? All four of us or more? By the way, please make sure that you get one of these on the way out. The reason that we give them to you is so that you can invite your, as I always say, your friends, relatives, neighbors, the people you work with. The next several weeks is going to be really solid stuff. And it is a reflection, hopefully, of our desire to be the kind of church we've been reading about, where we're actually seeing the Lord add daily those who are being saved. And here's why I say that. There are four areas in our community where we're trying to serve our community and be the hands and feet of Jesus, loving a lost and hurting world. One of them is in the area of addictions or hurts, habits, and hang-ups. And so we always talk about celebrate recovery. One of the other areas is where we help the materially challenged in our community through Grace Works, which, you know, we're just so grateful for so many serving through Grace Works. Another area is with our children. As you can see this morning, as the Tanners dedicated Sophia, I was actually talking to them earlier because we were trying to decide whether it was 2 years ago or 3 years ago that John and Natalie were baptized. It was 3 years ago. And it just becomes a part of the whole process of loving people and of asking God to use us to help people like John and Natalie to become a part of our community and to build our lives around Jesus together. Now, when we talk about children, by the way, we mean our children's ministry that will be known in the community as a church that helps people with their children, and of course in our student ministry. And this last Wednesday night, the 222 ministry started off with a great Wednesday night kickoff to the Wednesday night program. I'm actually going to come back and talk about that in just a second. But these are the areas that we're trying to serve. Well, one of the major areas where we're trying to serve the community is helping people with their marriages. So over the next 3 weeks, we hope it's ideal, and we're encouraging you to invite people. The radio right now, especially K-Love, is broadcasting about the Parrots for next Sunday and how they're going to be at the People's Church Sunday night as we partner with the People's Church for Fight Night. What they're not advertising on the radio, and we were told if we did that, we'd have way too many people here, is that they're going to be here Sunday morning. But you know that they're going to be here Sunday morning, and they're going to come, and Les Parrott is going to talk about how to be the kind of person who loves the life they live, whether their marriage is great or not. By the way, some of you who are single, it'll be very much a lesson that you'll be able to relate to. And then we're going to follow that up, as you'll notice, with the next two Sundays, talking about loving the life that you live, even as you stay and live life with your spouse, and how we keep marriages together. The week after that, how to interact as husband and wife. Again, these teachings will apply not just to married people, but to all people, because all of us at one level or another either are going to be married or will have influence on those who are married, or we are married and can benefit from it. And then again, on March the 1st, Tressa and Bobby Gibbs, Sunday afternoon, are going to do a special session on emotional and physical intimacy. I tell you all that because one of the hallmarks of being the church at its best is that we're going to constantly be seeking to minister to our community. if you'll notice here in the book of Acts, what it says, they enjoyed the favor of all the people. How do you enjoy the favor of all the people? By loving people. It's very hard not to listen to somebody who's loved us well. So as a church, we want to love our community well, and in the process, be able to tell them about Jesus. So we've identified these four areas as ways to do that. Now, something else that's going to be coming up that I wanted to mention to you is in about 2 weeks, when we start moving the dirt around for the building there in the middle, we think that God's going to bring to us people who will want to know about what's happening on this campus, and we think it'll be a really exciting time. And so I wanted to say some things this morning from this text that just help us with a mindset. And let me describe that mindset to you, and then maybe you can say it back to me, okay? Here's the mindset. The mindset is that I would love as Jesus loves. That let me just state it this way. To truly understand God in Jesus is to understand that in his holiness, I don't deserve anything but punishment, but because of his love, I am totally forgiven of everything. By Jesus Christ and his life and his cross and his death and his burial and resurrection, he promises those who surrender to him as Lord and Messiah, he promises that he will resurrect our bodies and take us to the new heaven and new earth, where all the greatest things, greater things than we can ever imagine, will come to pass. And the reason that we get that is not because we deserve it. The reason that we get that is because of his love. And so God, the Bible says, gives us his love. He actually pours within us the ability to love. And then catch this. Those who truly know him above all things, those who truly know him are epitomized by love. That's why Jesus repeatedly tells us that by this all men will know you're my disciples. Yesterday, we had a group of people here and we were talking about this. It's why in 1 Corinthians 13, the Apostle Paul says all these things that we can be about, and he sums it up and he says, but the greatest, but there's three things that remain, faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. And so we believe that the church at its best is grounded in God's love and God expressing his love through you and through me. And so here's my thing that I want to encourage us with. In fact, I'm just going to try to make this really practical. There's an expression that I really believe is grounded in the fact that God loves us and has called us to love as he loves. And it's a simple expression, but I hope that it helps you. I'm going to give you a real practical way that it can help, but I hope that the mindset will help you in all kinds of circumstances. Now, here's the expression. Love goes first. Can you say that? So when I was lost and heading to eternal damnation, Jesus went first. He actually went in history when our ancestors had lost the way. God went first. And in my life, when I came to believe in Jesus, it wasn't that I was such a good person and I found Jesus. Somehow, through people in my life, God went first. And then the Bible teaches us that we should demonstrate that in our own lives. We're always people who realize, because I have been loved, love goes first. So here's how it works just practically. I know Jesse Nelms, okay? Now, some of you don't know Jesse Nelms, but when Jesse Nelms here comes to church, some of you are going to see Jesse and you're going to think, who is that guy? And how should I greet him? Because one of the things that we as a people really want the community to know is how much we value love. And so the way they're going to know that is how we embody it. So as again, you know, we're doing these things in the community from Grace Works to the marriage ministry and all that. But all that can just be words and talk unless it's embodied by a person. So using just real practically, when we come to church, let's say that I'm a Harpeth person and I'm wanting to remember that love goes first and I see Jesse. Now, if I know Jesse, is pretty easy, actually. You know, he can look a little bit like maybe intimidating to some people, but not to me. I mean, after all, it's Jesse. So when I see Jesse, I go, Jesse, give me one of these. Right? Love goes first. What I'm talking about, by the way, is that interaction when people show up on the campus and you're seeing somebody that you don't really know. So if I know somebody, like I know Jesse, it's easy for me to love goes first and love him. But let's say that it's somebody that I'm not as sure about. Lois, will you be that kind of person for me? In other words, I'm coming in, do I know Lois? Does Lois know me? And what often happens in church communities is that it's really easy to be introverted and to kind of hold back thinking, well, like, who am I to talk to her, right? So I've asked Lois to represent that person I'm not sure of. And so Lois and I are about to see each other and our eyes meet. Now I can look the other way or something because I don't want to have that interaction, right? Or I can remember, oh, love goes first. Hi, my name's Bobby.
Hi, Bobby, I'm Lois.
Hey, Lois. Now, Ken, will you play somebody who you're just a newcomer, okay? And I see Ken coming and I think, I don't know him. And, you know, I don't know if he's been here a long time. Maybe he's just here recently. I don't know him. And I look at him, and what do I think? He's a newcomer, so I think love goes first. Hi, Ken.
Hey, Bobby.
Good to see you. Welcome.
Nice to meet you.
Actually, if I was doing this the right way, I wouldn't have known your name.
No, I wouldn't have known your name either.
So what I'm asking us to do, starting today and in the days that come, to remember love goes first in all of our interactions, because as somebody said to me before, who you are speaks so loud it drowns out your words. Isn't that the truth? Now, let me show you how this works really quickly in the book of Acts, and then I want to tie in a couple of other practical applications. So in the book of Acts, as you've seen it in chapter 2, in fact, if you look at it again, in chapter 2, it says how they loved one another. It says this, let me find it here, verse 44, and all who believed were together and had everything in common, so they literally sacrificed for one another, and then that led to the community seeing that and saying, hey, there must be something to it. Now, there's a pattern, and I'm just going to sum up the pattern here for you because we don't have as much time, but there's a pattern in the book of Acts in terms of the church's growth and the church's transformation of the community. Here's what the pattern is. God is present through the Holy Spirit or through miracles, or somehow God's present. So that's, by the way, there are three P's that lead to an O, okay? The P's are God's presence, clear proclamation, the gospel is clearly preached, and people practice love, and that leads to effective outreach or evangelism or growth. Okay? So all those events, all those things are present in Acts 2. So Acts chapter 2 begins with the Holy Spirit enabling them to speak in tongues. Peter gets up. So you have the presence. Peter gets up, and he proclaims the teaching of Jesus really clearly. By the way, friends, it's so important that we not shirk back or sugarcoat or somehow accommodate the teaching of Jesus, because people need to know the truth, even if they're uncomfortable, because that's what God uses to change hearts. And sometimes people think if we'll just kind of soft pedal it or accommodate it and try to fit in, that that'll make us more effective. The opposite is the truth. When we accommodate and when we soft pedal it, actually it doesn't breed conviction. People don't repent and turn to Jesus, and churches and preachers and people who do that become less and less effective over time. Even as they think somehow they're being more effective, they're actually being less. We have to be willing to be embarrassed by the gospel of Christ, and not embarrassed. Paul says, I'm not ashamed, even though people may think we should be ashamed for believing that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. We don't back off. We don't back down. We hold on to that because it's the power of God for salvation. So it's the power of God, the presence of God, the proclamation of the teaching of God, and then the practice of love in that community. So in chapter 3, you see the same thing going on. There's a man healed. then toward the end of chapter 3, Peter gets up and he calls them to repent. Then in chapter 4, all of a sudden, in fact, if you will, look at this. Chapter 4, verse 4, it says this. But many of those who had heard the word believed, and the number of men came to be about 5,000. So you see, in Acts chapter 2, 3,000 respond. In Acts chapter 4, through the proclamation, through the power of God, and through the practice of love, 5,000 men. That doesn't include women. So you can imagine there's probably 14,000 people. As best we can tell, there was 50,000 people in Jerusalem in the first century. About 15,000 of them are now following Jesus the Messiah through this process. Again, it's power, the proclamation, and the practice of love. Skip down to chapter 4, verse 22. I'm just going to stop here because our time, I want to be mindful of our time this morning. Here's what it says, though, about this love going first and the practice of love. It says, verse 32, now the full number of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one said that any of the things that belonged to him was his own, but they had everything in common. And with great power, the apostles were giving their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them. There was not a needy person among them, because as many were owners of lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold and laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each one as they had need. Notice the sense of love. There's not only such a sense of love that they're going to take care of all the needy people, but when the people are giving, and here you see a reflection, it wasn't just the tithe, it was the tithe and beyond. They lay it at the apostles' feet so that the whole community itself can be loved and taken care of. The ushers have a little card. I want to ask if they'll pass that card out to everyone. Last week, we didn't go ahead and pass out these cards because it just was the right thing to do to focus on Josh. Jack, can I have one, please? So they're going to pass these out, and I want you to walk through this. Now, here's what I wanted you to know about love in the midst of this, and I'll explain the card in just a second. In fact, we'll finish with me explaining the card. One of the things that most people want to do is we want our giving to God to express our love for God and our love for the community. I asked you to look at Acts chapter 4 because one of the questions that sometimes comes up with people is, well, do our tithes and offerings belong first and foremost to the local church? And typically what church leaders will say is that the tithe does belong first to the local church, and then offerings and extra giving are often given beyond the local church. And one of the bases of that is verse 35. Notice here, and this, by the way, is a pattern in the Old Testament, and it's a pattern throughout the New Testament, is they come and they lay their money at the apostles' feet so that the apostles can distribute it to everyone as they have need. Well, one of the ways that the church functions at its best is where people are trusting the leaders of the church to do that, to distribute the funds for the needs of God's people and to reach the community. So we encourage the same principle at Harpeth Community Church, and that is first fruits tithing to the church. Now, here's how it works. Aaron, who's our student minister, had a childhood buddy, I think it was a high school buddy, had come to church and was trying to figure out church and all that, and he came to a meeting. Aaron probably remembers this. I'm not sure when it was, maybe a year ago, and he came in, and it was in the youth center, and it was actually a young adults meeting, that's right, in the youth center, and he came in, and he said to Aaron, oh, wow, who pays for all this? One of the guys said, well, actually, you do. In other words, it's a thing that we do to serve the community. So when you hear of the great good done for Celebrate Recovery, through Celebrate Recovery on Friday nights, that's you and your tithes and offerings. When you can know about Less and Lessie Parrott coming to bless the community and bless marriages here, that's you through your tithes and offerings. When you hear of the student ministry on Wednesday night doing a great job kicking off this whole new system of discipling our youth, that's you through your tithes and offerings who are doing it. Even though Frank was preaching and Aaron was there and the music was there, that's you. You're present in those things. When we help the elderly couple at Grace Works, that's you through your tithes and offerings serving and loving the community. So I wanted to encourage you with that. In fact, this is a little bit risky, but I feel like I need to do this. One of the things that the church that's inhabited by the Spirit of Jesus and seeking to love like Jesus will speak truth, but it'll speak truth in love. And in our community, there's been a lot of talk lately. I've actually been subject to a lot of it. It's actually been in the newspaper and in the radio and all that, and that is a church. It's actually my neighbor is the leader of it, who's decided to break from the past, and they're encouraging and saying God is okay with the practicing of homosexual relationships. And it's really easy in our time not to say anything about that, but here's why I want to say something about it. The Bible's very clear that this kind of activity is not right in God's eyes. But let me just say this. If we just say that, and we are not a community that demonstrates the love for all those who struggle with not just that orientation, but we're all broken. And can I tell you the truth? None of us can make it on our own without a community that really loves well. So in the midst of trying to speak about the truth of the Bible, about morality, or the truth of the Bible, about all kinds of things, it will only honor God in the fullness if it's grounded in words of a community that really loves each other well. Does that make sense? Now, I want to show you a clip because one of the things I've tried to do without making this central in the church is to address this topic in a healthy way. It's on the minds of so many, but do it in a way that upholds what we always say, and that is both grace and truth. And there's a lady named Rosaria Butterfield who has spoken here in Nashville a couple of times in the last couple of months. She spoke at a gathering of pastors, and there was actually, they taped it. And then a couple of weeks ago, she spoke at a church in downtown Nashville on Friday night. We sent a link so that everybody who we have your email address can actually listen to it. It's one of the best presentations I've ever heard. And I want you to watch this clip in the midst of that as our community is talking about it, because it facilitates my point. And my point is this. If we really want to represent God well, we have to represent God through a community where we love each other, where we put our arms around one another. Now, in this clip, I wanted you to see it because Rosaria, she's now been following Jesus, as best I can tell, for about 15 years in this clip. But she was very involved. She was a leader in the gay and lesbian movement, and she still struggles a little bit with the church. And the reason she struggles with the church is not for what we believe, but it's our lack of love for one another and our lack of providing a community where people can actually follow God and get the support when they're weak, the support when they fall down. And I want to be that community. Don't you want to be that kind of community where we love each other and we're there for each other? I mean, the great thing about Josh is to see the number of people who have reached out in love to Josh, and I'm so grateful for that. We want that to be true for everybody in every area when we struggle. We love each other. If we're going to be exaggerated about anything, if we're going to give ourselves to anything, let's give ourselves to loving as Jesus loves. So please watch this clip, and when you hear conversations about the gay and lesbian lifestyle and all that, and when you know what the Bible says and it bugs you, don't let it spill out to a lack of love. Because woe to the man or woe to the woman who's oriented that way and is confused and needs help. Woe to them if they don't have a community that loves well. So let's watch this clip together.
Hello, I'm Russell Moore, president of the ERLC, and I have with me today on the platform Rosaria Butterfield. I've been looking forward to this conversation for a long time, ever since someone sent me little while ago, a couple years ago, I suppose, a copy of a new book. They said you really ought to read by this woman, Rosaria Butterfield. And it was one of those books that I thought I'd kind of thumb through a little bit and maybe put it aside and read it later on. And I found myself reading straight through it in all one night because it was such a captivating and powerful story. And so when we were talking about having this conference, the first name, and literally the first name that came to my mind was Rosaria. And so we're very honored to have you here today. I want to tell everybody, for those of you who are not familiar with Rosaria's story, she is an author and a speaker. She is a pastor's wife. She's a homeschooling mom. But before all of that, there was a time when she was a tenured professor at Syracuse University. She was in a lesbian relationship at that time. I think it's fair to say you were pretty hostile to folks
this.
Okay. Think
pretty
you maybe
safe,
written a book
safe
or
call.
Two about, So we'll talk a little bit about how you got from there to here. But before we do that, what do evangelical Christians just not get about the LGBT community?
One of the first things that I firmly believe you don't get is that in this very room and in all of your encounters, you will meet and know and love people whose original sin has left the thumbprint of unwanted homosexual desire. People are not different. Original sin is the great leveling playing field. It has democratized everything. And without meaning to, perhaps, I'm giving you the benefit of the doubt, I've come a long way. without meaning to, let's say, you are presuming that without even knowing the people with whom you're speaking, that they need to be fixed and fixed up in a specific way. So one of the first things that we could commit ourselves to doing is to being a community of believers who share the gift of repentance unto life in a way that other people can see. When I was in the gay community, somebody's home was open for fellowship or just for food or just to stand between you and that awful pit of loneliness every single night. Everybody knew there was a place to go. And from my experience, the church is living on a starvation diet of community. And I don't know why, but I can't live like that. And maybe the people you're witnessing to are put off by the message of the gospel of life because they don't want to live like this either.
The message, here's what she's saying. She is saying, and I totally believe it's from the Bible. It's the same thing as the Bible. The message of life is that God has given us life through Jesus. We all need to repent and follow Jesus, all of us with our brokenness. But when we repent and follow Jesus, we will starve in that pursuit without men and women and students who will wrap their arms around us and say, let's do this together. We can do this if we do it together in love. Our community, as a community of love, is essential for the gospel of love. Let's not starve each other, and let's not starve our community of love. Before Frank and the team lead us in a song, can I get you to look at the white sheet of paper? After the songs, I'm going to say a prayer for our offering this morning, and as I mentioned, we were going to give this out last week, but just felt like it wasn't the right time. And so we came back to it, and I thought, let's just go ahead. Let me just read it to you. I want to love a lost and hurting world. Is that true of you? Can you say amen to that? I want to love a lost and hurting world like Jesus did. So first off, I'm going to pray for a burdened heart for those not living as disciples of Jesus. Secondly, I will invite those not living as disciples of Jesus into our church community. Thirdly, I will do my part to demonstrate Christ-like love and hospitality to all. because love goes first. And thirdly, I will pursue tithing to my church and fulfill my Bridging the Gap commitment. If you need to take that home and think about it and bring it back next week, that's fine. But if you're ready to sign that and put it in the offering basket, I welcome you to do that. Because you know what? There was a day when all of us first came to faith in Christ. And you know, when people come to faith in Christ and they're saved, do you know that the Bible says, this is the only place where the Bible says this, the angels rejoice with God. And if the angels and God rejoice over lost people being saved, my own desire, and I know you share this too, is I want this church to be filled with conversion stories and lost people being found because they come to know the power of God, the preaching of the gospel, and the practice of love in this church. If you agree with that, can I get you to say amen? Amen. Let's stand and for this next song.
You guys could please be seated. Stand if you want to. But you may be seated.
Please watch, be seated for the next song, and after this song.
We just wanted to spend this time celebrating baptisms that have happened over the past few years, so we have some clips for you guys to watch.
He said, I've been where you've been before, down every hallway, a slamming door. No way out, no one to come and save me, wasting the life that the good Lord gave me.
Thank you. shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. Son and daughter, the King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I swing for all that you.
The Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave.
Sing, yes, sing.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
The bottom of our hearts we pray.
Worthy is the King who conquered the grave.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
Jesus.
Worthy is the King who conquered the grave.
The ushers to come forward and to go ahead and just pass out the baskets for our care and prayer cards and tithes and offerings. In just a second, I'm going to say a short prayer and encourage you to put into practice love goes first. That'll be interesting as everybody's trying to go first around the whole room. Should create a lot of good love going on. I wanted to tell everybody about something that we're starting up this coming Wednesday night. If you are not in a home group, we have a great opportunity on Wednesday night for the parents of junior high and high school students. We're actually creating a larger group, a community group, and we're going to be talking about it this coming Wednesday night at 6:30. If you'd like to come and learn more about that. It'd be a great opportunity not only to get into the Bible, to be in relationships with with people, but also to support your junior high or high school student by a group of parents coming together and having as one of their ideals to support their kids in the student ministry. So I want to encourage you with that. Also, I want to mention some of you have signed up for our Check Us Out seminar. We'll be starting that in just a few minutes. It'll be in the middle building. If you'll just go to the entrance there, there'll be some people to greet you. And then you'll be meeting in an office in the middle of the middle building. All right. Let's bow our heads and pray. God, thank you for the words of that song. This is Amazing Grace. That you would love us so much. God, may we honor your love for us by deciding, regularly deciding, that we would love like you love. And we pray, as you help us to regularly to decide that, that it would just become true of us, that we are people who love well. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you all. Have a great day.
This is amazing grace.
This is unfailing.